When the uranium fuel was sufficiently irradiated, the rod was pushed out the back of the reactor, down a chute, and into a pool of water.
They'd shut the reactor down, cool it down, and they would take the caps off of the process tubes that were going to be charge-discharge. And then the people on the front face would then hook up the charging machine and they would push out the fuel that had been in there.
The worst thing in the world that you could do was push out a fuel element and it hung up someplace on the discharge side. It was out of water, didn't have any cooling. It's a pyrophoric material. If you get air on it, it will flash on you. It'll burn itself right in the air.
After being pushed from the process tubes, the uranium fuel would land in a chute and slide down into the storage basin.
They had long tongs, and they had a bucket, and they would put the fuel into that bucket. And they had a particular pattern they put it in, and they knew how many levels of fuel elements would be in that particular bucket.
You weigh the fuel baskets before you started, you weigh the fuel baskets after you had them fully loaded. Now you know exactly how many fuel elements you had.
Now here in the storage basin, the fuel sat for, usually about 90 days. They're about to allow the short-lived fission products to decay away.
The reason why you want to store them? Short-lived isotopes. What isotopes are really important? Iodine-131, the thyroid-seeking isotope. It collects in your thyroid. What happens when your thyroid gets bombarded with 131? It kills it.
While the radioactivity from the fuel rods was very dangerous, the 20 feet of water in the storage basin shielded workers from the radiation.
There wasn't any special requirements for radiation protection. And actually, fuel, when it first came out, you could take a look at it, and it was glowing. You could see the hot fuel there as it was slowly cooling down.
Material that is discharged from the reactor, is even after it decays for 90 days, it is still extremely radioactive. They put it in these cast carts to take it up to the separations area, and between the cast cart and the locomotive, they would usually put in 4 or 5 blank railroad cars to separate the locomotive engineer from the cast cart. And they would usually move the cast cart at night, because they had to barricade the roadways, because anybody waiting for the train to pass would get a pretty healthy dose of radiation.
Handling irradiated fuel once it left the B reactor required and received extreme caution.